In this lecture, we will review some of the concepts from operating systems that are required in this course on virtualization and cloud computing. So these are the concepts that we will cover in today's lecture. The concepts of a process, virtual memory, kernel mode execution, interrupt handling, and I/O handling. Note that you should already be familiar with these concepts beforehand, and this lecture is only going to provide a brief recap of these concepts. So let us begin with the concept of a process. What is a process? It is nothing but a running program. So users typically write programs, any C, C++ programs, or you know, any applications like a browser or an email client. All of these are programs which are compiled and an executable is generated. So what does this executable contain? It is a sequence of CPU instructions. So every CPU is capable of understanding and executing certain instructions. So the CPU architecture defines certain instructions. For example, the x86 architecture defines instructions like add, move, and so on, right? And when a user writes a program in a high-level language, a compiler translates this code into a sequence of CPU instructions that can be executed on the CPU. This is what the executable contains. So in order to run this program as a process, the operating system first allocates memory for this process. Every process must reside in RAM, in main memory, and must be allocated some memory by the operating system. So the OS allocates memory in the form of a memory image of the process. So this memory image of the process contains the following parts. There is usually some code. This is from the executable. Whatever program was written and compiled, the CPU instructions, that is the code of the process. There's also some static global data that is allocated at compile time. That is also included in the executable. Then there is the heap. So some amount of extra memory is allocated for the process in the form of heap in order to handle dynamic memory allocation. That is at runtime when the program is running and requests memory, say via malloc, then this memory has to come from somewhere. This won't be part of the executable, right? Because this happens at runtime. And there is a heap area. Some memory is given to the process to serve as the heap to give out memory for malloc kind of allocations. And finally, there's also the stack. So whenever a function call is made, so some memory is required to store the arguments, local variables, return address, and so on for the function call. Again, this memory cannot be allocated at compile time, right? Because you do not know what functions will be called at runtime. So this stack is also some memory that is allocated during the execution of the program. So a memory image of the process contains some memory earmarked for all of these things. And all the components in the memory image are assigned addresses. Say the code is starting at byte 0, the heap is starting at byte 100, the stack is starting at byte 200, and so on, right? So all the components, all instructions and pieces of data in the memory image are assigned addresses so that the CPU can say, okay, give me this instruction at this address, give me this data at this address, and so on. And these addresses start at 0 and can go on up to the maximum value that is supported by the underlying architecture. For example, in 32-bit systems, you can store a 32-bit address, which comes up to 4 gigabytes. Okay, so this is how the memory image conceptually looks like. When the operating system has to create and run a process, it takes the compiled executable from disk, copies it into memory, copies the code and data from the executable into memory, allocates some extra memory for the heap for dynamic allocations, allocates some extra memory for the stack to store arguments and other things during function calls, and creates this memory image of the process. And all elements in this memory image, whether it is instructions, code, data, integers, all of them are assigned byte addresses, right? For example, the code is starting at address 0, the heap is starting at address 12 KB, and so on, right? So this is the memory image, and these are the addresses assigned to each of the instructions and data in the memory image. So the heap is where allocations happen via malloc. So whenever you request some memory via malloc, some address here in the heap is returned back to you so that you can store some data in this heap. Similarly, when a function call is made, a data structure called a stack frame is pushed onto the stack, and inside the stack frame you will store data pertaining to that function call, like arguments, return address, local variables, and so on. And another function call pushes another stack frame, pushes another stack frame onto the stack. And when the function returns, these stack frames are popped. So storage for function call related variables happens on the stack. And usually some portion of the memory image is left unused also. Not all addresses are assigned, because the memory image might expand in the future. For example, the heap and the stack usually grow towards each other, right? As the heap expands, as you do more and more malloc, the heap grows like this. And as you push more function stack frames onto the stack grows like this. So there is some buffer zone of unused memory in between the heap and the stack, right? So these are all the components of the memory image of a typical process. So how does the process execute? So when the process executes, the CPU executes the code in the memory image. That is, the CPU registers hold various values related to the process execution, and the process keeps on running on the CPU. For example, in x86, there is a register called EIP. This is also called program counter. This program counter points to the current instruction to run, has the address of the current instruction. So what does the CPU do? When the EIP or the program counter is set to point to a certain instruction in a program, the CPU fetches the instruction, decodes it, executes it. Then the program counter increments to the next instruction. You fetch the instruction, you decode it, execute it, and so on. Right? So whenever a process is executing, the PC or the EIP register in x86 points to the address of the current instruction that is running. Okay, note that every CPU architecture defines a certain set of registers. And in this course, we will primarily be referring to the registers by their x86 names, like EIP for the program counter. Now, when an instruction is executing, you might also have to store certain values from memory into registers. For example, the add instruction might require you to fetch a value from memory, store it into some register, and then perform the addition on these register values, right? So there are a few general purpose CPU registers available in which you can load data or operands into the CPU registers, perform the operation, right? So examples of these general purpose CPU registers are EAX, EBX, and so on in x86, right? So the EIP is a special register, which is the program counter, and these are general purpose registers. You can get any piece of data from memory, store it into these registers, and perform operations. So after an instruction completes, suppose you've added two registers, stored the value in a third register, then eventually you will have to store back these values from registers into memory. So typically the CPU fetches the data into registers, performs an operation, and stores back the value from the CPU registers into the memory image, into the variables in your program. That is how the variables in your program get updated. So there's also another register called the stack pointer, which points to the top of the current top of the stack. That is, your stack might have multiple stack frames on top of each other due to multiple function calls. And the stack pointer points to the current top of the stack. So the next time you make a function call, from this value that's pointed by ESP, a new stack frame will be pushed. So the set of all of these CPU registers, the values of all of these CPU registers, is called the CPU context of a process. So when a process is executing, the CPU context holds all the information related to the execution of the process. Which instruction is running, where is the stack pointing, what is the current operation running, what are the values of all the registers. So all of this is called the CPU context of a process. Okay. So this is how we can see it pictorially. This is the CPU. It has various registers which store values. And when a certain process, this is the memory image of the process in RAM, which has code and data, heap, stack, and so on. And when this process is running on the CPU, the program counter points to some memory address. Say the program counter has a value of 12, saying the instruction at byte number 12 is running on the CPU right now. Similarly, the stack pointer points to wherever the current top of the stack is. And all of these registers might also have some memory values that are fetched into the CPU for various operations, right? So this is called the CPU context of a process. So next, let's understand a few other concepts like context switching. So to run a process, the OS allocates memory, forms the memory image, loads the CPU context of the process, that is, sets the EIP to point to the instruction in the process, ESP points to the stack of the process, the registers have process data. So when the CPU context is loaded, the process begins to run. Okay. So running a process is nothing but setting the EIP to point to the instructions in that process. Now, the OS does not run only one process at a time. Operating system runs multiple processes concurrently by multiplexing them on the same CPU. That is, after a process runs for some time, the OS will context switch away. That is, it will move from one process to the other and again come back to this process, then jump to some other process. In this way, the operating system has multiple processes, active processes, and it keeps jumping from one to the other and runs all of them on the same CPU. In this way, the OS gives all of these processes the illusion that they are all executing at the same time concurrently. So this mechanism of switching from one process to the other is called a context switch. So how does the context switch happen? Initially, the operating system is running one process, say process P1 is running. And if the OS wants to switch to process P2, what will it do? It will save the context of process P1 somewhere and it will load the context of process P2. So EIP was initially pointing to the instructions in process P1. So that EIP value is removed from the CPU and a new EIP value that points to the new process instructions is loaded into the CPU. So when you save the old context and load a new context, then a context switch has happened. A new process is now running on the CPU. It's as simple as that. So now where is this context saved? Note that when you stop a process, you cannot throw away the context. You have to save it somewhere so that you can restart that process at a future time. So where is this context saved? The operating system has a special data structure called the process control block or a PCB. Okay, so for every process, you have one PCB and the operating system maintains a list of these PCBs for all the active processes, for all the programs that are running in the system. There is one PCB each. Okay, so there is a list of PCBs for all processes. And this PCB contains a field where the context can be temporarily stored. Okay, so in some operating systems, this field is also referred to as the kernel stack. So the PCB has a kernel stack, and within this kernel stack, you will store the context of a process. Okay, so let us visualize this context switch. Now, initially, these are the memory images. Suppose there are two processes, a blue process and a green process, and the CPU has all its registers. And all of this is the user part of the memory, right? These are the user programs. And in the RAM, there is also some kernel memory where the kernel executable, the kernel's data structures are stored. So in the kernel part of the memory, there is a list of process control blocks, one for each process. So this is a kernel data structure. Okay. So now initially, we have the blue process running. The CPU EIP is pointing to the blue process's code, ESP is pointing to the blue process's stack. The CPU context of the blue process is there in the CPU. Now, to perform a context switch, what do? You take this context, save it into the PCB of the blue process, and then you go to the PCB of the green process and load this green processes context into the CPU. That is, you save the old EIP value here in this PCB and you load the new EIP value back into the CPU. At this point, what has happened? The CPU has switched execution from blue process to green process. Earlier, the CPU was executing, EIP was pointing here, it was executing this code. Now, it begins to execute this code, right? So, this is called a context switch. So, the operating system continuously performs context switches like this from one process to the other. There could be tens or hundreds of processes running on a CPU, and the OS continuously keeps performing context switches in order to give each process a slice of the CPU. So that completes our discussion of the concept of a process and a context switch. Now we'll move on to understanding virtual memory. Okay, so far we have seen that when a memory image is formed, all the instructions in data in the memory image are assigned addresses. So these addresses are what are called virtual or logical addresses. And these are the addresses that are used by the CPU. The CPU will say, give me instruction at address byte number 4 or byte number 8 or so on, right? So these addresses in the memory image that are used by the CPU to access instructions and data are called virtual or logical addresses. Note that these are not the actual addresses occupied by the instructions or data of the process in RAM, right? These are just logical virtual addresses assigned from zero for convenience, okay? It is not possible for every process to have its instructions and data stored from byte number zero in RAM, right? That is not possible. So these are only virtual addresses. Every process assigns addresses starting from zero to all its instructions and data for convenience, and these are called virtual addresses. On the other hand, the actual physical locations where these instructions and data bytes are stored in RAM are called physical addresses. Okay? And in order to access any piece of information from RAM, you have to know the physical address. You give the physical address to the RAM hardware and it will return back the bytes to you that are stored at that address. So the CPU requests, when the CPU is running a particular process, it will request code and data at virtual addresses, and somebody has to translate these virtual addresses into physical addresses so that the actual code or data can be fetched from RAM. Okay, so now we will understand how this address translation happens. So before we go that, note that in most modern operating systems, the concept of paging is used. You should be familiar with it already. So what is paging? Memory is not allocated at a granularity of a few bytes, but it is allocated at the granularity of pages. So page is typically 4 KB and memory is usually allocated in chunks of 4 KB. That is, the memory image of a process is divided into logical pages of 4 KB size, and each of these logical pages are stored in 4 KB physical frames in memory. Okay. So for address translation, you need to translate from this logical page numbers to the physical frame numbers. Okay, so let us understand this process in more detail. So this is the virtual address space of a process. This is how a process sees itself in terms of virtual addresses. There is the code, data, heap, stack, all the parts of the memory image, which are assigned addresses starting from zero, the next piece of data has the address 4, 8, whatever. You have continuously a set of addresses assigned to various pieces of code and data. This is the virtual address space. But in reality, in RAM, what happens? The memory image is divided into pages, and each page is stored at a possibly different physical address in RAM, right? So the memory image is not even stored contiguously one after the other in RAM. It is divided into pages and each page can be stored anywhere in RAM. For example, this page addresses 0 to 4 KB. The first page might be stored at some address that's starting at value X in the RAM. Similarly, the second page can be stored starting at address Y, the third page at address Z, and so on, right? So the pages are stored non-contiguously somewhere in the RAM and they are assigned certain physical addresses. Now, suppose the CPU, the EIP, say, is pointing to some piece of code here and it says fetch the instruction or fetch the data at address 5KB, the piece of information located at byte 5KB. So when the CPU says fetch, you cannot take this 5KB, go to RAM, right? The RAM hardware will not understand what this 5KB means. So this must be translated, and you know, you must know that this is in page 0, this is page 1, it is in page 1, and it is 1KB into from the start of page 1. You should know that the first page is 4KB, therefore 5KB means go to the start of this page and go 1KB inside. Therefore, you must translate it into, okay, go to address Y, then go 1KB inside. So address Y plus 1KB is where you must actually go to in the RAM and fetch this piece of code or data. Okay, so this is called address translation. So how does this address translation happen with paging? There is a piece of hardware called MMU, or memory management unit. This is part of the CPU, and its job is to translate virtual addresses into physical addresses. Okay, so the operating system maintains a data structure called the page table. So the operating system manages the entire RAM. It knows where are all the free physical frames in memory. So when it is creating a process, it knows what frames have been assigned to the pages of a particular process. Therefore, the operating system builds and maintains this data structure called the page table, which stores a mapping from page number to frame number for all the pages in the process of every process. There is a separate page table for every process, which stores page 0 is placed here in RAM, page 1 is placed here in RAM. This information for each process is stored in a separate page table. And the MMU uses this page table to translate the addresses. So how does MMU know where the page table of a process is located? So there is a special register in the CPU. In x86, this is called CR3 register. Okay, so there is a CR3 register of the CPU in which the address of the page table, the physical address of the page table of a process is stored. Okay, so every process has a page table. The address of it is stored in CR3 register. So on every memory access, what does the MMU do? It will go to the CR3 register, find the page table, look up the page number in the page table, translate it to frame number, and then go to RAM and fetch the actual memory. And then go and access the memory, right? So on every memory access, MMU looks up CR3 and translates the address. Note that the CR3 register stores the pointer to the page table of the current process. Okay, so every time there is a context switch, you move to another process, there is a different page table, you have to update CR3. And finally, MMU also has a small cache called the TLB, where the most recent translations are stored. So for every memory access, go access the page table, do this translation, compute the physical address is a bit of a pain. So the most recently accessed translations are stored in the TLB as some sort of a cache. Okay, so let us try and visualize this. So here is the virtual address space of a process. The process has a bunch of pages, and these pages are mapped to different locations in RAM to different physical addresses. And the CPU has the CR3 register, which points to the page table. For example, it says this page 1 is stored at some frame number Y somewhere in memory. Okay. So this CR3 points to the page table of the current process. Now the MMU is in charge of address translation. So whenever the CPU says fetch a certain address, fetch a certain virtual address, the MMU takes this virtual address, breaks it up into page number and offset. Note that the higher order bits indicate the page number and the lower order bits will indicate the offset within the page, which byte are you at, right? So you take the virtual address, you split it into page number, offset, then take this page number, look up the page table, find out the actual frame number, get the frame number, and then add the offset, that will give you the physical address. So this is how the MMU uses the page table that is found in the CR3 register and translates virtual address to physical address. Now, when the CPU says fetch whatever is there at address 5KB, the MMU does all this translation, translates it into a physical address, and this request for this address goes out to the RAM, and then the data can be fetched from the RAM. So this address translation happens via this small piece of hardware called MMU. Note that the operating system is not involved. The operating system simply generates the page table and gives it to the CPU. After that, on every memory access, the CPU is directly accessing the code and data of the process and executing them and translating addresses. The OS is not directly involved in every address translation. So another important concept to understand is the concept of hierarchical page tables, right? Or multi-level page tables. Again, you should have seen it in an operating systems course earlier. So modern operating systems, they use hierarchical page tables. So let us understand the need for this. Suppose you have a 32-bit virtual address space, that is a process's memory image can go up to 4 GB, and suppose the page size is 4 KB. Then each process can have, this is 2 to the 32 by 2 to the 12, it can have 2 to the 20 pages in its memory image. And for each page, you have to store the pointer to the physical frame number and all of that. You have to store a page table entry for each page. So a process can have up to 2 to the 20 page table entries in its page table. And assuming each page table entry is 4 bytes, this works out to about 4 MB. So this page table of a process itself is 4 MB in size, right? This is a large value. Now, where do you store this page table? It also has to be stored in memory, but memory is only allocated at the granularity of pages of 4 KB chunks. So what do? You cannot store this big 4 MB page table contiguously in memory anywhere. So this itself is split, the page table itself is split into smaller page size chunks and stored in memory. Okay, so each 4 KB page can store 2 to the 10 page table entries, right? Because each page table entry is 4 bytes, so 1K or 2 to the 10 page table entries you can store. And therefore, this 4 MB page table will require 2 to the 10 pages to store all the page table entries of a process. Now, how will you give all these 2 to the 10 pointers to the MMU? You cannot. So then what do you do? You store pointers to all of these inner pages in an outer page directory, right? So your page table is split into two to the 10 parts, and the locations of all of these 2 to the 10 parts are stored in an outer page directory. And if they don't fit in one outer page directory, if you have multiple outer pages, then you store the pointers of all of them in another outer page, right? So you can have multiple levels of the page table. So in 32-bit architecture, there are only two levels of the page table. There are the inner pages and there is one outer page directory. But in 64-bit architectures, you can have more levels in the page tables. You can have 4 or 5 levels in the page table also. Okay, so let us visualize this. So here is the page table of a process, or the part of the page table of a process. What does the page table contain? It is nothing but an array of page table entries stored in order, page 0, page 1, page 2, page 3. This is an array of page table entries. And every page table entry has, among other things, a physical frame number. You know, the location of where this page, page number 0, is stored in frame number 32 in RAM. That information is there in the page table entry. It has a pointer to the physical frame. And a process does not have all the page table entries, won't fit in one page. You have an array of page table entries that is split among multiple pages. So we've seen that for 32-bit virtual address space and 4 KB pages, you'll have 2 to the 20 pages in the process. Therefore, 2 to the 20 page table entries have to be stored for every process. And these will fit in 2 to the 10 pages. We have seen this calculation on the previous slide. So now you have 2 to the 10 such pages, each of which contains an array of page table entries, right? So this is the inner page table of a process. Now the addresses of all of these inner page table pages have to be stored in a outer page table, right? So in 32-bit architectures, luckily, this 2 to the 10 pages can fit into one outer page table. But if they can't fit into one outer page table, if you have multiple outer page tables, then the pointers to all of this have to be stored in another level outer page table, right? So this can go on until finally everything fits into, all pointers fit into one page. Okay, so you can have multiple such levels in the page table. And finally, this outermost page table's address is what is stored in the CPU's CR3 register. Okay, so the CPU CR3 register stores a pointer to this outermost page directory, which has pointers to the next, which has the addresses or pointers to the next level pages, which might have address to the next level pages and so on. Finally, the last level of the page table has the actual frame number that is of interest to us. So how does the MMU translate an address? The MMU has a virtual address. The virtual address has a page number. So this page number, the higher order bits of the page number will tell you which of these inner page tables to use, right? So you take the virtual address, take the top 10 bits, it will tell you which of these 2 to the 10 page table entries to use. Then you find the inner page table. Then the next 10 bits will tell you which of the inner page table entries to use. Then you look up this inner page table entry and you find the frame number, right? So this process is called walking the page table. So you walk the page table in order to, so if you have a multi-level page table, the MMU has to access multiple memory locations. It has to take the CR3 value first, look up this page directory, then it has to look up this inner page table. You might have to do it multiple times until you get a frame number. And then from the frame number, you add the offset, you get the physical address, and then you go to RAM and go ahead and access the piece of code or data that is there at that physical address. So before you do a memory access, you might have to do multiple other memory accesses for the page table. And therefore, to save all of this effort of walking the page table, once you have translated a virtual address to physical address, this mapping can then be cached in the TLB of the MMU. So that in the future, you don't have to go access the page table. You can just quickly look up this mapping. So the TLB is a cache that stores only the most recent translations. So another quick point to mention with respect to paging is the concept of demand paging. That is, in general, not all pages will be assigned physical frames. They may not be physically present in memory. For example, the OS may not have allocated a physical frame for this particular page. And the physical frame will be assigned and data will be copied from disk only if this address is accessed by the process. For example, if the CPU says fetch some piece of code or data on this page, then when the MMU tries to translate this address, what happens? There is no page table entry for this page. Then it will result in a page fault, right? So the process thinks this memory is allocated to it, but the OS has not allocated the underlying physical memory to it. Therefore, the MMU does not know how to translate this address. It raises a page fault, at which point the operating system comes in. It finds a free page, maps it into this page table, and the page table is updated. And once again, the CPU instruction is rerun. The page fault is handled by the operating system. So when it comes to things like page faults and all of that, what is happening? How does the operating system run? In order to understand that, we have to understand the concept of user mode and kernel mode of a process. Okay, so before we start, let us clarify that there are roughly two kinds of CPU instructions. There are what are called unprivileged instructions and there are what are called privileged instructions. So unprivileged instructions are instructions that are there in regular program code, you know, load this piece of memory, add these two registers, all of that is unprivileged instructions. On the other hand, some special instructions which require, say, access to hardware, write to this device, read from this device, all of those are what are called privileged instructions. And these must be run as part of the operating system code, whereas unprivileged CPU instructions can be run as part of the user code. So modern CPUs have multiple privilege levels. So in x86, these are called rings. x86 CPUs have four different rings, four different privilege levels. And privileged instructions are executed only at a high privilege level. For example, when the user code is running on the CPU in x86 is set to ring 3. And this is, so ring 3 is the lowest privilege level, right? So this is the user mode. So when the user code is running, the CPU is set to ring 3, and user can only execute unprivileged instructions. Now, when the CPU is in ring 3, if the user code has any privileged instruction in its executable and tries to execute a privileged CPU instruction, then the CPU will throw an error. Okay? And similarly, the OS code can have certain privileged instructions. And when the OS code is running, the CPU is set to ring 0 in x86. So this is a very high privilege level. This is also called kernel mode. There are also rings 1 and 2 that are not very commonly used. So usually ring 3, the lowest privilege level, the user code runs. And at the highest privilege level, the OS code runs. Right? And the OS code, now when the CPU is set to ring 0, here you can run any privileged instructions that you want. So who checks these privilege levels? This is checked at multiple places. The CPU, for example, checks the privilege level. If the CPU has fetched an instruction and is about to execute the instruction and it sees that it is a privileged instruction, but it sees that the CPU is in ring 3, it is in user mode, then the CPU will not run this instruction. It will raise an error. And the operating system will handle the error. So if a user code tries to sneak in a privileged instruction, the CPU will throw an error. Similarly, this privilege checking is also done by MMU. So every page has a bit indicating whether it is a user page or a kernel page. So if the user tries to go and access addresses in a kernel page, then the MMU says, oh, the CPU is in ring 3, it is in user mode, but this is a kernel page. User is trying to fetch some code or data from a kernel page and it will throw an error, right? So there are multiple places where this privilege level is checked. So now if a user process needs to do a privileged action, needs to access hard disk or needs to access RAM or any other IO device, what should the user code do? When the user code needs to perform privileged action, it must first jump to operating system code, which is privileged. It must set the CPU to the high privilege level, and then it can perform a privileged action. Okay, so the user code by itself cannot perform privileged actions. It must take the help of the operating system code in a high CPU privilege level in order to perform privileged actions. So to understand how this is done, so first of all, we must answer the question, how can it jump to operating system code? Where is the operating system code located? So this is the virtual address space of a process and all the pages are mapped to some physical frames in the physical address space. So the important thing to understand is the OS is part of the virtual address space of every process. That is, certain virtual addresses in Linux, 32-bit Linux, it is typically addresses 3GB to 4GB are reserved for the operating system, right? So the operating system code resides at these virtual addresses. So what does that mean? It means the page table of a process maps these virtual addresses to the actual location of the kernel code in memory. So the operating system is present at certain location in the RAM. This location, these frame numbers are inserted into the page table of the process at these virtual addresses. So every process, if it jumps to certain high virtual addresses, then it can execute operating system code. But note that there's only one copy of the OS code in memory. It's just that the page tables of multiple processes will map to the same operating system code. So every process does not have its own copy of the operating system code and data structures. All processes share the same copy of the kernel code and data structures and everything in memory. Just that this code appears in the page table of every process. So that any process, if it wants to execute operating system code, it simply jumps to these addresses, executes this code, and it can go back. Right? So every page table contains a mapping to this kernel code and data. And anytime the process wants to execute operating system code, it simply jumps here, runs this code, and then goes back. Just like how a process, if it wants to execute some function, it will jump to the function code and go back. Similarly, it will jump to the operating system code, run it, and go back. So the operating system is part of the virtual address space of every process. So kernel mode execution. Now let us understand how this operating system code is actually run. So when does a process go from user mode to kernel mode? There are three different events. The first is a system call. when the user requests some privileged action from the operating system, that is called a system call. For example, in your program, you might make a open system call to open a file, a read system call to read a file, and so on. The second reason why a process will go from user mode to kernel mode is if there is some fault in the program. The program has done some invalid action and the hardware has raised a fault. For example, the user code tries to execute a privileged instruction when in user mode. Then the CPU will complain and it will immediately jump to the OS code and say, oh, please do something. This process has done something wrong. Similarly, when there is a page fault, the MMU is given a certain virtual address to translate, but that virtual address does not have a page table entry in the page table. There is no frame number. The MMU cannot translate that address, at which point it will raise a fault. It will jump to the operating system and say, hey, do something about it. I don't know what to do. So anytime there is some illegal action by the user program, immediately the process goes from user mode to kernel mode and jumps to the operating system code. So the operating system comes in from time to time to handle certain exceptions by the user program. And the third reason why a process can go from user mode to kernel mode is if there was an interrupt. An interrupt is basically an external hardware device knocking on the door and saying, hey, I need some attention. Something has happened. For example, if a packet has arrived on the network card will raise an interrupt and say, look, here, take this packet. Okay, when that happens also, the process stops executing whatever code it is running in user mode and has to jump to kernel mode. So all of these things, system calls, program faults, interrupts together are called traps in general, right? They are all handled in the similar fashion by the operating system. So how is a trap handled? Any of these events, how are they handled? Note that some of these traps are sort of voluntary, like system call, the process itself requests for a trap. Whereas some are involuntary, like program faults and interrupts, they're not in the control of the process, but all of them are handled similarly. So when a trap happens at a high level, what do? The CPU first realizes a trap has happened and it sets itself to a high privilege level because it knows now it has to start running operating system code. So the CPU moves to a high privilege level and then the EIP jumps, the program counter jumps to the operating system part of the code, which can handle this trap, and that code, that operating system code is run. And then once the trap has been handled, it can return back to the user code and resume execution of the user program. And it can return to the same process, it can return to another process, it can do a context switch. Once the kernel is running and it has handled a trap, it can also perform a context switch and go to some other process. Okay, so let us look at this trap handling in more detail. So this trap handling begins with the CPU executing a special instruction. So until now, the CPU was executing certain, you know, add, jump, move, whatever instructions are there in the program. Once a trap happens, the CPU stops whatever it is doing and executes the special hardware instruction, which is called int n. It is called the int instruction in x86. Other architectures might have other names for it. So whenever there is a system call made, this int instruction is run. Whenever an IO event happens, an interrupt occurs from the IO device, this instruction is run. So this instruction is executed by the CPU anytime a trap happens. And what happens during this int instruction? Whenever the int instruction is executed by the CPU's privilege level changes. It goes to a higher privilege level. That is, in x86, it jumps from ring 3 to ring 0. Then, now it has to jump to kernel code, right, in order to handle the trap. Now, how does it know which kernel code to jump to? That is where the CPU has a pointer to this kernel data structure called the interrupt descriptor table. So, every trap comes with a certain number n. If it is, say, an interrupt from a mouse, there is a different number. From keyboard, different number. System call, there is a different number n. So whenever a trap happens, the CPU knows what was the cause for the trap. And it uses this number n to index into a table to find out which part of the kernel code should I jump to. Okay, and the EIP is set to this value, right? So now EIP was initially, say, running user code. Now the EIP jumps to the kernel code, which is obtained from the IDT. And similarly, the stack pointer of the CPU also points to the kernel stack of a process. This is again a special stack that is used when a process is in kernel mode. So on the kernel stack, all the operating system related function calls happen. Just like how user programs use the user stack, the kernel mode execution of a process uses the kernel stack. Okay, so the EIP jumps to kernel code, the ESP points to the kernel stack, and the user context, whatever was the values of the CPU register when the user code was running, wherever it was pointing to, the EIP, EAX, EBX, all of those are stored onto the kernel stack. And now the kernel code can begin execution. The kernel code runs, it handles the trap, and after it can save more user context and it can handle the system call, interrupt, whatever the trap was, it can handle all of that. And then the kernel code invokes a special, again, another CPU instruction called IRET, which basically reverses whatever intended. This will change the CPU's privilege level, restore back all this EIP, ESP values, and go back into user mode. So the CPU instruction INT10 goes into kernel mode. This IRET goes back into user mode. Okay. So let us visualize this process in a bit of detail. So here is the CPU that is executing some user program. The EIP is pointing to the user's code. ESP is pointing to the top of the current stack frame, and this user program is running. And now suddenly some event has happened. Say the process made a system call, or some IO event has happened, or there was some program fault, whatever. Something has happened and somebody has raised an interrupt. Okay. At which point the CPU stops whatever set of instructions it was running and executes the special INT N instruction. As part of this instruction, what happens? The CPU changes its privilege level. Earlier it was ring 3, now it goes into ring 0. Then it looks up this IDT data structure, finds out which address to jump to, and the EIP is now set to that address, to some kernel code the EIP is set, so that the kernel code can run and handle this trap. Similarly, the ESP is also set to point to the kernel stack of the process. Note that the kernel stack of the process is just some kernel memory that is given to every process, so that the process can store all its, you know, function calls and all of that information in this special area. So the PCB of every process has a pointer to the kernel stack. Right? A process does not want to store kernel related information in the user stack, so you jump to the kernel stack. Okay. At this point, whatever was the context, the state of the CPU registers, the old value of EIP, old value of ESP, all of that is stored into this kernel stack. Right? And now you can start executing operating system code. So this is how a trap is handled. You first run the INT10 instruction, change your privilege level, jump to the OS code, save the user context, and now EIP is pointing to OS code. The OS code runs, handles the trap. Whatever needs to be done to handle this interrupt or program fault or system call is performed by the OS. And after all of this is done, the operating system will say, okay, now restore back this user context. Let's go back to user mode again. The old value of EIP, the old value of ESP, old value of all the registers is restored. And the user process resumes execution again after handling the trap. Okay, so just a small note about this interrupt descriptor table. So every interrupt has a number. So different hardware devices get different numbers, system call gets a different number, and so on. So whenever this interrupt is raised, whenever the hardware sends a signal to the CPU, or the MMU sends a signal to the CPU, or software invokes this int n instruction, then at that point, using this number n, you can find out which kernel code to run. Okay, so the IDT has a list of addresses for each IRQ number, which kernel function to run. Okay, so the IDT entry specifies the value of EIP and a few other such CPU registers, such that this interrupt can be handled. So when a certain nth interrupt occurs, you look up the nth entry of the IDT, decide which kernel code to jump to, set the EIP to that value, and then you can locate that particular kernel code and start running it to handle that particular interrupt. Okay, So how does the CPU know where the IDT is? The IDT is once again a special kernel data structure, just like how, you know, you give a pointer to the page table. The pointer to the page table is stored in CR3 register. Similarly, there's a special CPU register in which you store the address of the IDT. So that whenever an interrupt occurs, whenever a signal comes from any hardware device to the CPU, it can look up the IDT and find out where to jump to in the kernel code. Okay, so setting this IDT is also a privileged operation. Any random process cannot just set the IDT to any value. It is a privileged operation. This is done only by the operating system. So we'll take a small detour here from kernel mode execution to understand this idea called segmentation. This is again useful for us in the virtualization course. So segmentation is just an alternative way to manage virtual memory. Like paging, it is an alternative to paging. So segmentation existed before paging came up, but now mostly most operating systems use only paging. But we will need this knowledge of segmentation in the future. So in paging, what do? You divide the memory image into fixed size chunks and place them in RAM. With segmentation, you divide the memory image into segments, the code segment, the heap segment, the stack segment, and so on, into more logical pieces. These may not be the same size, right? They can be widely different sizes. So you divide the memory image into segments and then place these segments non-contiguously in memory. Okay. So every segment has a start address and end address, which is also called the base and the limit. And this is how you divide up the virtual address space and place it into the physical address space. Now, when the CPU says fetch some address 1 KB within the code segment, what will you do? You know the start address of the code segment in memory. It starts at this address B code, and then you want something 1 KB into this. So then you add 1 KB to the start address and then you get your physical address. This is how address translation is done with segmentation. Okay, so let us look at this in more detail. So the CPU has certain registers called the segment registers. Okay, they are named CS, DS, SS, ES, FS, GS. There are multiple of these registers in x86. Each segment register stores a pointer to the base and limit of that segment. Now, the base and limit of every segment for all the segments are stored in a table called the segment descriptor table. And the CS stores a pointer into this table, which is the CS stands for code segment, DS stands for data segment, SS stands for stack segment, and so on. There are multiple such segments. So for each segment, you don't store the base and limit values directly in the CPU registers. Instead, you store them in a kernel data structure called the segment descriptor table. And the CS, DS, and all simply store indexes into these tables. So for example, if the CS stores a value 1, it means you look up entry number 1 in the segment descriptor table and use that base and that limit. Okay. So the base and limit values are stored in a table and index into that table is stored in these segment registers. So if you are using segmentation, then this is how you will translate addresses. Okay. So the CS register will contain an index. You use that index into the segment descriptor table. And inside that segment descriptor table, you will find the base and the limit values of that segment. And then you use that for address translation. So the MMU will basically, if you have to translate 1 KB in the code segment, then your virtual address with segmentation will look like the name of the segment followed by offset in the segment. That becomes your virtual address. So your virtual address will be CS and 1 KB within the code segment. So then what will the MMU do? It will see the segment number. Oh, it is the code segment. So it will refer to the CS register, which has an index. It will use this index, look up the segment descriptor table, find out the base, the starting value of this segment, and then it will add the segment base to this offset and finally get the physical address. This address is also called the linear address because it does not have two parts like the segment and offset, but it is one address. Therefore, it is also called the linear address. And at this point, the MMU also checks, is this address more than the limit? You also know the max value of the segment. So if this address is more than the limit, the MMU will throw an error, right? So the start address is used to add to the offset, and the limit is used to check that you're accessing within the code segment and you're not accessing memory outside the segment. So if you access memory outside the segment, it causes a fault called the segmentation fault. You would have seen this in programs. Anytime you access an array beyond its bounds, it throws a segmentation fault. Even though segmentation is not used today, the term, the name segmentation fault has remained. Okay, with segmentation, this is how you translate a virtual address into a linear or a physical address. And finally, this address is used to go access the main memory. But anyway, after all of this, it's a bit of an anticlimax to know that segmentation is not widely used today. Okay, you have both segmentation and paging, but modern operating systems use only paging in practice. Note that the hardware, the CPUs are built to do both segmentation and paging. There is the CS, DS, all of these registers are there in the CPUs today. Okay, in addition to CR3, which stores pointer to page table, CS, DS, all of these registers store pointers to the code segment, data segment, and so on. So the registers exist, the hardware exists, but modern operating systems do not use segmentation. They only use paging. So then what do they do? What do they store in all of these existing segment registers? So modern operating systems, what they do is they use flat segments. That is, your segment table will have segments like this with a base value of 0, limit of the maximum value, say 4 GB. What does this mean? You're just adding 0 to the virtual address, right? So when you translate a virtual address using segmentation, it does not change. It stays the same. So you're saying all segments are starting at address 0 and ending at address 4 GB. So these are called flat segments, right? So this is basically nullifying the effect of segmentation. Okay. So by using segmentation, the address translation is not happening. The virtual address remains the same. And then what do? Then you use this virtual address after segmentation-based translation. Then you take this virtual address, walk the page table, and paging actually does the translation. So while the hardware has both segmentation and paging, and the MMU is built to do both segmentation and paging, that is, the MMU is built, for example, if you're accessing EIPs pointing to certain address, the MMU is built to do the following. It will first look up the code segment, add the base of the code segment to the address, and then look up this address in the page table to get the physical address. The MMU is built to do both segmentation and paging one after the other. But modern operating systems, what they do is they always use a base value of 0. They use flat segments so that segmentation does not change the virtual address and only paging is used for address translation. Okay. And so adding a segment base of 0 does not change. Your virtual address remains the same and only paging gives you the actual physical address. So segmentation is sort of obsolete today, except it has one use, which is to check permissions. Okay. So modern operating systems use this dummy flat segment, but they have different segments for different privilege levels. Okay. The code segment, for example, always has a base of 0 and a limit of max value. So this base value is usually pointless, has no impact. But the segments also store a privilege level. So when in kernel mode, the code segment has a base 0, but the segment table has a value indicating this is a high privilege segment. When in user mode, the segment table has a value indicating this is a low privilege segment. Okay. So the CS, the code segment, points to two different entries in the segment descriptor table when in user mode and when kernel mode. And both entries are identical except for the privilege level. Okay, so segmentation is used today mainly to enforce privilege level. Okay, when you jump from user mode to kernel mode, the code segment changes from one flat segment at low privilege to another flat segment at high privilege. Okay, and therefore, by looking at the code segment, you can actually know what is your privilege level. Is the code segment pointing to the unprivileged flat segment or the privileged flat segment? Based on that, you can figure out what your privilege level is also. Okay, so segmentation is mostly not used by operating systems. It has no role in address translation, but it has a certain role in checking for permissions and knowing which privilege level you are at. And this is how x86 CPUs run. Now you might ask, why bother with segmentation? Why don't we just remove it? Note that it's not possible to change the hardware, right? The hardware has to maintain a certain backward compatibility. Therefore, these segment registers are there. Just that modern operating systems don't use them much, except for checking these permissions. So the last topic we'll cover in this lecture is how the I/O subsystem works. Again, you should have seen this before, and this is just a quick recap. So what happens when a process has to access I/O device? Say you have to read a block of data from the disk. A process uses a system call. Suppose there's a process P1 makes a system call in order to read something from the disk. Then the system call will cause this process to go into kernel mode. The system call code invokes the int n instruction. You jump into OS code that handles the system call. And specifically, you jump to the OS device driver. The device driver is what communicates with devices. So this OS device driver, what does it do? It initiates an I/O request. Say if it's a disk or a network card or whatever, it starts an I/O request. This I/O request might take a long time to complete. Such system calls are called blocking system calls, right? The disk might take a long time to read a block. So what do? Now the OS, process P1 has come to kernel mode, OS is running. Now the OS can decide, okay, I don't want to run P1 anymore. And it performs a context switch to another process, P2. Now, when this process P2 is running, at some point in the future, this I/O request might complete. And this device will raise an interrupt. The disk will say, hey, I read your block of data. Here it is. So when the device raises an interrupt, now which process is running? P1 is not running. P1 is blocked. P2 is running. Now this P2, because an interrupt has come, it goes into kernel mode, handles the interrupt, and takes the data that has come from the disk or whichever device. And it might mark P1 as ready because now P1 system call is complete. And at a later point of time, the scheduler might run P1 whenever its turn comes. Okay, so this is the life cycle of an I/O request. And you all should be clear on how this is happening. So one small thing to note here is the concept of DMA or direct memory access. So when initiating an I/O request, when the OS device driver initiates an I/O request, what it does is it provides the address of a memory buffer in which to store I/O data. Now, suppose you're asking the disk to read some data. What the OS does is it allocates a small memory buffer, some kernel memory, and gives it to the disk, gives the address of it to the disk and says, hey, whenever you finish reading, put the data here. And then the device first stores the data in this memory buffer before raising an interrupt. So that by the time the interrupt is raised and the kernel can handle the interrupt, the data is already there in memory. The kernel does not have to copy this data from the device memory into main memory, but the data is already present in main memory, right? So that is the purpose of DMA. It speeds up interrupt handling. And why does it speed up interrupt handling? Because the interrupt handler does not have to copy data from the device memory to the RAM. So almost all high-speed modern devices like disks and network cards are all DMA capable. Whenever a network packet arrives, the packet is first copied into some kernel memory, and then the network card raises an interrupt. Then the kernel mode execution will handle that interrupt. By the time the interrupt is raised, the data is ready. So this is the final summary. These are all the concepts that we've seen today. We've understood the concept of a process, the memory image, CPU context, and understand how the CPU context is saved in the PCB or the kernel stack when switching from user mode to kernel mode, as well as during context switches. So multiple times the CPU context is saved in the kernel stack. We've also seen the concept of virtual memory, paging, and address translation. This is an important point. The OS is mapped into the virtual address space of every process so that a process, when it has to make a system call or handle a trap, it can simply jump to high virtual addresses, run OS code, and then go back to its own code. The OS is mapped into the address space of every process by the page table. And there's also the concept of segmentation, but modern operating systems mostly use flag segments and predominantly rely on paging for address translation. We've also seen the concepts of user mode, kernel mode of a process, privileged execution, privileged instructions, various CPU privilege levels, and so on. The important thing to note is modern CPUs have multiple privilege levels, and operating system code, which contains privileged instructions, will only run at the highest privilege level, which is ring 0 in x86. If a user program tries to execute privileged instructions when in user mode, when the CPU is in, say, ring 3, then the CPU will throw an error. It will not allow user program in user mode to run privileged instructions. We've also seen how interrupt trap processing happens in kernel mode, how a user process jumps into kernel mode, jumps to kernel code, saves user context, executes kernel code, and then returns back into user mode. We've also briefly seen how I/O handling happens. So all of these concepts should have been learned by you in a previous operating systems course before we can proceed ahead in this virtualization and cloud computing course. So these are all assumed as part of your prerequisite. So I hope that all of these are clear before we can proceed ahead in the course.